Good evening. Welcome to the midweek service here at Harvest Baptist Church. To those that are here in person and to those that are watching on the live stream, hi, Mom. I know you're watching tonight. This is every service is important at church, but the midweek service, because of the prayer time, is of the utmost importance. And that's what really gets us going and moving forward as the weekend approaches. And I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to our continued study in the book of John tonight. But first, as we always do, let's start by singing some songs. So let's stand together if you are able, and we will sing Tell It to Jesus. Tell It to Jesus. Are you weary? Are you heavy-hearted? Are you weary? Are you heavy-hearted? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Are you grieving over joys departed? Tell it to Jesus alone. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that's well known. You've no other such a friend or brother. Sorrow, tell it to Jesus, tell it to Jesus. Are you anxious? What shall be tomorrow? Tell it to Jesus alone. Tell it to Jesus, tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that's well known. You've no other such a friend or brother. Tell it to Jesus alone. Thought of dying, tell it to Jesus, tell it to Jesus. For Christ's coming kingdom, are you sighing? Tell it to Jesus alone. Tell it to Jesus, tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that's well known. You've no other such a friend or brother. Tell it to Jesus alone. Are you weary? Are you heavy-hearted? Covering a whole wide range of things there. Are you weary, heavy-hearted? Are you anxious of what shall be tomorrow? Are you worried about the thought of dying? And you know what? You can tell all that to Jesus. And you know what else? It says he is a friend. He is a friend that's well known. And that's not us taking it lightly. That was his words himself, talking about being our friend. And that's Jesus, our friend. And we're going to go to him tonight, and we're going to tell it to Jesus. And if there's a prayer request that you have that you haven't been telling to Jesus, you need to, because he's waiting, casting your care upon him because he cares for you. And let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you the honor and the glory today. Lord, we just thank you as you sit upon the throne. And Lord, we know that it is your will that we surrender to your will in each and every area of our lives. And Lord, we thank you that as you created the entire expanse of the universe, you created each and every one of us, and you know even the very hairs in our heads, and you can tell them by number. But Lord, even in the midst of all of that, Lord, when we come to you, it is no burden. It is no inconvenience. Lord, it's nothing to you. It's everything that we do come to you. And Lord, we're going to come to you tonight in prayer. Lord, help us as we think about you and who you are up in heaven. And Lord, as we think about your Son, Jesus Christ, and salvation, Lord, I just ask that tonight, as we study your word, Lord, that you would meet with us. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Let's sing about that fountain. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. A fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, and sinners sinners plunge beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Dear dying lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Till all the ransomed church of God be saved sin no more. Amen. Praise the Lord for that fountain, Jesus' fountain, filled with his blood that he spilled at Calvary for the remission of our sins. All right, time now for our missionary letter. And rejoice with me as I've got some correspondence from the Branscombes, missionaries to undisclosed locations in Asia. And you'll hear from this letter. I'm not going to read the entire letter. I'll pass it around. As you can see, it's quite the letter. But I will share some highlights with you from that. And as we pass it around, you can take a look and read about what they're going through. I will tell you that they are in the U.S. On a, I guess it would be kind of a forced furlough because of the Chinese government over there and what happened with coronavirus and whatnot. But they are here in the States and just praying about what it is that they would do next. So we will start here. It says, we are writing from the U.S., having just begun a scheduled furlough. So it was scheduled, but it was scheduled for approximately a year. But it sounds like a simple statement, but behind it lies many praises. They were in Thailand and Myanmar when the virus situation caused them to unexpectedly wait, hoping for improvement. But as they saw the window to re-enter China possibly closing, we flew back to China to ordain local leadership and prepare our church. Indeed, the borders soon closed to foreigners. We are so glad we made it into China. Our family struggled through being required not to exit our apartment door for 17 days. All right, yeah, yeah, we're stuck in their apartment. Now, remember, this isn't an apartment like we think of apartments. This is apartments in China where there are a billion more people, you know, or more people. So it's apartment for 17 days. Not only that, the only time they could open the door was for virus testing. And on top of that, it says this was not a self-quarantine, but an enforced one. All right? All right? At one point, our neighbors, listen to this, were pounding on the door, calling for our removal, or threatening to seal us inside. God provided a brave friend to set food outside our door and to help make peace with the neighbors. See, what it is the nationals there do not like foreigners in that regard, especially with the virus. So they wanted them out of there. You foreigner, you brought this virus, or whatever it may be, whatever they've been told, whatever it is that they believe. But can you imagine that? Being secluded in your own place, small, tiny apartment with your family, 17 days, you know, that's enough in and of itself. But to have people pounding on your door and just screaming at you and doing all these different things. You know, they have children. Terrifying. But nonetheless, they went through that. And thankfully, we were healthy and safe despite the public sentiment swinging suddenly against foreigners. Our community leaders eventually released us and later allowed people who didn't live inside the complex to enter. This meant our church people could trickle in, and we held training sessions with the couple who had already been praying about taking over leadership. The difficulties of dealing with the impact of the virus compounded when a renewed crackdown on churches also began in earnest in our city. Okay, so crackdown on churches is a pretty big deal over there in China, and they take it seriously. Some, I'm not saying that this is the case with them, but some churches, they won't even allow you to even as much as have a hymnal in there because it might contain the Word of God. So nonetheless, so they've got the you know, the quarantine. They've got the neighbors screaming at them. They've got trying to figure out what they're going to do. with their nationals, which they're, you know, training them up to run the church. Now they've got the government cracking down on churches, going through all these different things. And so we could see the Lord had helped us work ourselves out of a job in regards to training a new national, so there was reason for praise. It was a monumental occasion when Antioch Baptist, the church over there, along with the agreement of our home church, Midland Baptist of Michigan, joyfully ordained Pastor John. March to June was intense on all fronts, and in fact, we saw souls come to Christ and many dreams come to fruition. Okay? So it said we had already scheduled a furlough with our pastor and reach with our local Pastor John, but this need was reconfirmed as things intensified because of the virus and general growing tensions and agendas within and towards China. Previously available options for exit by land and sea were not allowed, and the airline who sold us tickets was not truly flying. Just one flight out per week was allowed per airline. Our visas expired, and extensions had already been granted with the understanding that we would exit. So through all of this, they inflated the price of airline tickets, and the cost for their airline ticket was $13,000. Yeah. So $13,000 for that. Now, they had been taking up offerings. Various places have done that. They've raised $6,800 of that, but they're still just asking if they could receive some support in regards to that. So I'll pass that around. Want to take the time to go ahead and read all that. I was glad to be able to find that. You know, that's a mission. Harvest Baptist Church supports the Branscombes missionaries to Asia. And I was glad to find that. I hadn't seen any correspondence in quite some time. And pray for our missionaries. I know some of them are probably a little discouraged because I'm not seeing the correspondence that I used to see. And that's, you know, I understand that. I'm not saying like, hey, what's going on? You know, some of them may be just not reporting because they believe there's nothing to report, and that's okay. You know, the report out for that when they send their correspondence is more or less for us to understand where they're at and for us to pray for them and to support them. Some churches will flip the script and say, you know, they use it as a way of checking in on the missionaries. That's not our job. It's God's job to overlook that, and God knows what's going on. It's just our job to pray for them, to encourage them, to do anything we can to help them out when we can, and to do just that. So pray, if you think about it, pray for our missionaries. It's on the prayer bulletin to pray for them, but just pray that they'd be encouraged and that, you know, and I try to reach out when I can to keep correspondence going with them. All right, a couple of announcements here. One, I've got the Trash Day Weekly rotation. I had to make an update. This is my fault, because what I had done is I put Sunday dates on there, and the trash goes out on Wednesday nights, and that created some confusion. So I updated that, but we need a volunteer tonight to check the trash cans. If we could get a volunteer to do that tonight, just to go around. There is a list right here that tells you which ones you need to check. And I believe there's only one trash bag. Eric, you gonna volunteer? Okay. Oh, okay. Well, yours was previous, it was a mix up. All right, so Eric Justice, thank you very much. I appreciate that. I'll write your name on there. All right. Amen, indeed. There's a list of things to check. We've only got one big trash bag in the can. I think it can go out tonight, and we'll see how full it is after we empty them all. If not, we can leave it. We don't have to take it out every week. All right. That's it. Then let's see here. What else do I have for announcements? We've got the sign-up sheets in the back for the picnic, which is on August 22nd. It looks like we're getting a lot of people signing up for that. That's wonderful. It's going to be a good time. It's at Merritt Township Park in Munger. And it's going to start at noon, and we're not going to stop until the last person leaves, and that's when we'll know it's over. So go ahead and on the back table there. There's been a lot of people signing up for things. Make sure you get signed up for that if there's something you want to offer or do in regards to that. But most importantly, make sure you show up. I'd love to see everybody there. It's going to be a good time. Pray for good weather. We don't know. You know, it's all a little less than a month from now. So just pray for good weather, a nice day. Pray that, you know, we wouldn't get any trouble from anybody for gathering. But nonetheless, we'll do what we can to maintain our good testimony. As you can see, if you were in the fellowship hall, it looked like, you know, we talked about our teen takeout night when we take back all the cans, and it looked like we ended up with more than what we started with. And in a way, we did. What happened was we did have it Sunday night. We loaded up the vans, drove out to Meijer, and we started going in there, and there was a lineup. And lo and behold, we weren't in the lineup. We waited in the line. Some people were able to go and do that. And then all of a sudden, they're like, nope, You can't take any more back. Everybody's got to leave. Our truck is full. The machines are full. Everything's full. We're done. You guys got to go. So we had to pack all the bottles up, bring them all on back, and then bring them back here to the church. So we'll figure it out. It's just an opportunity, just another chance to go out to be able to do that. So we'll figure it out one way or another. I don't feel as bad for the one lady that had an entire, how long was that trailer, Dan? It was a long trailer full of bottles. What it was, she wanted to send two of her boys to Boy Scout camp, and it was $3,000 a piece. So they had this entire trailer full, and they said, we've been trying for 3 weeks to take these back, and they just can't do it. So just pray. We'll figure it out. That's a good problem to have. I thank you for all those that have given bottles that will go to the teen ministry, with the exception of the ones that were given specifically to go for our parking lot. All right, so we'll look in regards to that, and that is it. Hey, Sunday, good news. We're going to be observing the Lord's Supper. I am excited about that. Ah, praise the Lord. That's going to be a wonderful time. Be ready for some testimonies about what the Lord has done in your life. Be ready for that. We're going to do that because the Bible says this, do in what? Remembrance of me. And we're going to do the Lord's Supper. We're going to talk about testimonies of God. Let's not be ashamed of our Lord. Let's not be ashamed of Jesus. Let's give him the honor and praise and the glory he deserves and bring a testimony. And we'll do that, and we'll just testify of the Lord and his greatness as we observe the Lord's Supper. And after that, pray about how the Lord would use you. Because we are going to start our benevolence fund, okay? After, what will happen is after the morning service, there will be a plate in the back, and if the Lord so leads you to do so, you can put the money in that plate, and all that money on the plate that's going to be in the back will go to our benevolence fund, and it can be used internally or externally as helping those in need within the church or reaching out to those without. And there are procedures for that to make sure that we're good stewards with what God has given us. But again, it's an opportunity to reach those in our community and do what the church is supposed to do. And, taking care of the widows and the orphans, helping the homeless, and so many other things that we're supposed to do as a body of believers. So, all right, speaking of offering, Eric, are you ready? I asked Eric if he could be the fill-in usher, and he said yes. And then I promised him he would not have to pray. So I will pray over the offering tonight. But thank you, Eric, for stepping up yet again. And I appreciate everybody that steps up and steps in for everything. That's one thing that's great about this church is, and when there's a need, there's always somebody there to fill it. All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time we have together. Lord, I thank you for the testimony of the Branscombes. Lord, thank you for keeping them safe and getting them home. Lord, I praise you that by your grace, they were able to come up with a $13,000 for their flight. Lord, that was no surprise to you. But Lord, I just pray that as they continue to try and raise support, that anybody that could be a blessing in any way to them to help them out, that your will would be done. And Lord, I just thank you that that we have missionary friends that we can pray for and encourage. And Lord, help this offering tonight. Lord, I thank you for the faithfulness of everybody here at Harvest Baptist Church as they give according unto you, and you use it for your honor and your glory, for this is your church. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Sing our final song this evening, Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through his infinite mercy, his child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus, no language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord for that. All right, I have got some yellow cards here that I'm going to pass out right now. We are not taking a vote on anything. That's not what this is about. But what I want is, as you know, as I told you, that tonight when we do have our prayer time after our Bible study here in just a moment. What's that, Eric? Yeah, actually, if you could come out and do that. What we're going to do is, remember tonight I said we were going to have the men pray with the men and the ladies pray with the ladies. That's what we're going to do during our prayer time. But on this yellow card, I would like you, and I'm giving these to you now, so if the Lord puts somebody on your heart throughout the Bible study, you can write it down. Is I just pass out one to everybody. Just write down the name of somebody that you know that needs salvation. And we're going to keep that. We're going to keep these cards. What will happen is we'll pray together, and that will be one of the key things that we pray about, is somebody that you know that needs to be saved. And you know, there's lines on there. Maybe you could write down more than one name. You can write down a couple of names. Just make sure we can do that. We can pray for people that need to be saved. And after the prayer time, we'll turn them in, and I'll hold on to them. And then every week, we'll pass those out amongst others, and we'll continue to do that. And we'll just start praying for people that we know that need to be saved. I think that's a good thing to do, right? Amen, indeed, yeah. So we'll start doing that, praying for people that need to be saved, and then we'll pray together, like I said, tonight when the prayer time comes, it'll be men with men and women with women, and again, we'll just have a wonderful time of prayer. But now, let's open our Bibles to the book of John, chapter 6. John, chapter 6. John, chapter 6. And we're going to start in verse 22, John chapter 6, verse 22. John chapter 6, verse 22, the Bible says, "The day following, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was none other boat there, save that one whereunto his disciples were entered, and that Jesus went not with his disciples into the boat, but that his disciples were gone away alone. Howbeit, there came other boats from Tiberias nigh unto the place where they did eat bread. After that, the Lord had given thanks. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping and came to Capernaum seeking for Jesus. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, when camest thou hither?" Let's pray. Dear Lord, help us during this time we have together. Lord, I thank you so much for your perfect, your infallible, and your powerful word. Lord, just help us tonight as we continue our Bible study. Lord, help the word to just come into our hearts. Lord, help it to come in and penetrate our hearts. And Lord, just fill us up. Lord, that we may bring forth fruit that remains. Lord, use us during this time that we have together. Lord, I pray over the teens, the teen ministry tonight. Lord, I thank you for Paul and Darlene and everything that's going on there. And Lord, it looks like Eric's helping too. So Lord, in autumn, Lord, just have your hand upon them as they reach our teens here at Harvest Baptist. Lord, I pray that our teen ministry, we would reach more in this community with the gospel of Christ, that our teen ministry would grow. And Lord, same with our Harvest Critters, our young ones and our little ones in our junior church, Lord, as we continue to do that as well. Lord, I just look forward to what you're going to do in our hearts and in our lives. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So continuing on, the book of John chapter 6, and I left you kind of with a cliffhanger last week when I said a big crowd doesn't always mean it's a believing crowd. A big crowd doesn't always mean it's a believing crowd. Okay? Now, the idea here is not for us to judge the crowd. That's for God to do. But we must understand and stay grounded in regards to what it is and what we're doing. And I'll explain why when we get to the end of the lesson tonight. But we see here what's going on. They had just seen the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. They saw what Jesus had done. And we see that because it's referenced in verse 23. It says, "Howbeit there came other boats from Tiberias nigh unto the place where they did eat bread. After that, the Lord had given thanks." So they had partaken. They had seen the miracle. They understood what had happened. And now there's a crowd. There's a multitude gathering around saying, "Did you hear about what happened? Did you see what happened?" And then many of them were involved. They're like, "Yeah, I was there." And there's a big crowd, and there's people following. And not only are they following, but they're looking around saying, "Hey, where'd they go? Where's Jesus? Where's he at? Let's get in our boats. He's not here. He's not there. Okay, let's get in there. Let's go find out where he is." And they're pursuing him. And on their way, they're looking for him. And they find him. We see that in verse 25. "When they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, when camest thou hither?" They said, "What are you doing over here? What's going on?" And they looking for him, and they found him. But we see something about this crowd, and there's a couple of different things, four different things that I've written down that we can learn tonight. Now remember, when you study your Bible and you look at God's word, you know, sometimes we want to look at these people and be like, "Oh, can you believe it? Can you believe these people, what they've done? Can you believe their attitudes?" But you know what? Let's not forget, so as much for some of you, and myself included, these are people just like us. And these are people that have gone through things and are going through things just like we do. And sometimes we have the same attitude. But the best thing we can do when we study our Bible is when we look at it is to draw the truth from it, see if there's any of it that applies to our lives, and fix it and get it better and grow closer to God. That's what sanctification is, you know, listening to the Lord, listening to the Holy Spirit, getting in the Word, allowing the Word to impact you, and listening and being obedient to what God wants you to change as you grow into the image of Jesus Christ. And our pursuit is to be like Christ. And that's what it means to be a Christian. Christian, and they were called Christians first in Antioch because they were what? They were little Christs. It'd be look at them. They're like a bunch of little Jesuses going around. What a compliment that was back in the day. Is that the same today? Now, obviously, the world will have a different view of the word Christian, but that's not the way we are to judge it. We're still to judge it by the Bible definition of the word. Are we acting like Bible Christians, little Christs? And that's what it's about. So let's take a look at these people and look at this crowd and see what they did and see how Jesus handles it. Okay, because Jesus does handle it. And I'll tell you what, we're going to go all the way to the end of the chapter in the few moments that we do have. And to look at it through man's eyes, through man's perspective, some would say that this is a colossal failure. You say that about Jesus? No, I didn't say that about Jesus. But if somebody were to act in the same spirit as Jesus and do exactly things the way Jesus did and have the same result, they would say, "Wow, they messed that up. They had a big crowd. And well, let's see what happens." Okay, so these people come across and they said, "Hey, whence camest thou hither?" Verse 26, we see by the words of Jesus that they had the wrong mission. Verse 26, "Jesus answered them and say, Verily, verily, I say unto you, ye seek me not because ye saw the miracles, but because ye did eat of the loaves and were filled." Ouch, calling them right out. Now remember, this is Jesus, okay? Now, if this is me in my flesh, when I read that, I want to say that he said it like this. "Verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled." But look what he says in verse 27. He says, "Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat that which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him hath God the Father sealed." So again, we want to look at it and be like, "Ha ha, busted," right? But that's not what he's saying. Think of the compassion that he has, because we can see that in verse 27. He's like, "Listen, you guys didn't come here because you saw the miracles, but you were filled." He's like, don't do that. He says, "Labor not for the meat which perisheth." He's like, "You guys are missing the point." See, and that's really what what he's getting at. He's telling them that they're missing the point. He could have rebuked them, and there is a bit of rebuke in what he's saying. You know, I'm sure if I were to come to Jesus and be excited about something and he gave me a good rebuke, which I would deserve, and even though he did it in a good spirit, I would kind of be cut a little bit, not because I was offended per se, but because, you know, I disappointed my Savior. Say, oh, you know what, I want to have the right heart when I approach my Lord. But we see that, and he sees, again, and we're going to see a pattern here with this multitude coming after Jesus, and sometimes that's us as well, is sometimes we have the wrong mission. We have the wrong mission. We want, you know, as the book of James says, is that we ask amiss, that we may consume it upon our lusts. Sometimes we pursue the Lord for fleshly reasons, you know, that our bellies may be filled. Sometimes we pray unto the Lord because we don't want to be faced with an inconvenience. I don't want to go through this, Lord. Just, Lord, just make it go away. Now remember, the Lord didn't call us to a life of convenience, but a life of character. And sometimes he puts us through certain things to grow us. Everything we go through should grow us to some extent. But nonetheless, he says that to these people here in verse 28. Here's their response. Then said they unto him, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? Interesting. Interesting here. Again, you know, they're pursuing him. They're looking. They've heard about the miracle. And he says, you didn't come to me because of the miracle. You came to me because you were filled. Your bellies were filled. And they're like, well, all right then. What is it that we can do? What is it that we need to do that we might work the works of God? Isn't that interesting? Sometimes we do that. Sometimes we want to go to Jesus. We want to ask for a blessing, ask for a miracle, and then say, all right, get out of my way. All right, Jesus, you know, get me through this situation and then step aside. And sometimes, you know, the world will do that too, seeking out the Lord. They just want to get into the position where they don't need him anymore. And that's not the case. Our pursuit of Jesus should not be with the mindset that I want to grow in Christ to where I don't need him anymore, because as we grow in Christ, we will realize that we need him more and more. And that's the idea here. But nonetheless, we see that. They're like, well, what must we do? As in the book of Acts, I believe it was Simon the sorcerer approached Peter, and he says, you know, how much? He's like, how much to purchase this power that you have? That's not what it's about. You know, it's not about that. It's about just trusting in and resting in him. In verse 29, Jesus answers them and said unto them, this is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent. Now remember, that brings us back to John 20, 31, the key verse, and it just reiterates that in regards to what the whole purpose of everything is. John chapter 20, verse 30, it says, and many other what? Signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. He's like, listen, it's not about the bread and the fish. It's not about having your belly filled. It's not about, you know, these miracles that I'm doing that are mine to do through the will of the Father. You guys are missing the point. He's saying, this is the work of God, that you believe on him who he hath sent. In verse 30, they said therefore unto him, what sign showest thou then, that we may see and believe thee? What dost thou work? Isn't that interesting? Remember, as we left off last week in John chapter 6, verse 21, it says, then they willingly received him into the ship, and immediately the ship was at, oh wait, let me see here. There we go. Verse 14. Then those men, when they had seen the miracle that Jesus did, said, this is of a truth that prophet that should come into the world. See, they believed through the seeing of the miracle. These people, remember, excuse me, saw the miracle. They were a part of it. They partook of it, but yet here they are asking for a sign. What sign then shall we see? Were you not just there? But we do that too. We do that too. God comes through, answers our prayer in a miraculous way, and he meets our needs, and he takes care of us, and then another situation arises, and we think, how's God going to do this? Lord, give me a sign. Right? And he's done it all along. You know, I'm glad God gives me more of the benefit of the doubt than I do him sometimes. You know, sometimes I'm more inclined to believe the devil than I am the Lord, and that's terrible. We all do that from time to time. We just fall into the worst case scenario and get all anxious and all nervous and all worried. And when you're doing that, you're believing the lie of the devil. You're not putting your trust in the Lord. But here they are again, blinded. What sign then? Show us a sign. You know, if I were Jesus, I would have been like, excuse me, weren't you just on the other side of the lake? But no, They see that. They want to see the sign. Verse 31. Very interesting. It says, what sign will you show us thus? Verse 31. Our fathers did eat manna in the desert. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Really? I mean, man, they're just really getting, again, praise the Lord for Jesus, because I would be just downright insulted. Here I, gave thanks unto the Father, fed 5,000 with a few loaves and fishes from a small lad, so much so that I had 12 baskets overflowing with the fragments, filled to the full, and yet these people follow me. Give us more, give us more, give us more. Well, you guys, you saw the miracle, but you're missing the point. Well, then give us a sign. You know what? Our forefathers had bread coming from the sky. Can you do that? Can you do that? But Jesus being Jesus, praise the Lord, he's Jesus. Verse 32. Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. You see, he's getting to the point there. He's like, yeah, I know you're talking about our forefathers. You're talking about that. He's like, they didn't get it from Moses. Our Heavenly Father rained that down from heaven. Verse 33, for the bread of God is which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. The manna, as we see in the book of Exodus, or all through the Old Testament from that time forward until, I believe it's the book of Joshua chapter 5, when the manna ceases to rain from above because they are in the promised land. They have crossed the Transjordan. But we see here the manna really is a picture of Christ. Now we're talking about that on Sunday nights, when we are co-studying the book of Hebrews and the book of Leviticus, and we're seeing the correlation of God, what he's doing is painting a picture of things to come, and he did the same thing with the manna. Manna, heavenly bread, from what? From heaven, from the Father, came from above, just like Jesus, fell on sin. In the book of Exodus, chapter 16, they're in where? The wilderness of sin. And the manna from heaven rained down on sin, just like Jesus coming down on sin. It was a free gift of God, and it satisfied God's people. The manna is a picture of Christ. Now, some people will talk about its purity and its sweetness and so on. There's a lot of parallels that you can draw between the manna in heaven and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And that's really what he's getting to. Now, what Jesus is doing is he's taking, and this is, only Jesus can do this, but he's taking what they're saying, and he's slowly bringing them. And we'll see. Actually, just hold your place. I'll tell you, in verse 63, he says, it is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. So he's taking where they're at, and he's taking it and he's turning it and applying it in a spiritual way, which Jesus does. Praise the Lord. He did it with the woman at the well. Took the things that she said and turned it into a spiritual conversation. And that, and I'll stop right there just for a moment. That's a wonderful way to soul win, to witness, is to be always on the lookout, always be ready to take any conversation and turn it into something spiritual. And you do that when you're prayerfully asking for an opportunity to do just that, and you're surrendered to the Holy Spirit and to who? The will of the Father. And we see that. That's what Jesus is doing, taking what they said and he's turning it. He could have, not Jesus. Jesus will not, because he's perfect. But any one of us would have been very frustrated in that situation. We said, you guys chasing me down, going all across this water, saw the miracle I just did, and then saying it's not good enough and doubting me, just be gone with you. I'm done. I don't have time. But not Jesus. He keeps going. So he's saying there, bread of God, verse 33, which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. Verse 34, then said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. Just continuously going over their head. Verse 35, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Remember John chapter 4? He's the living water, and now he's the bread of life. Amen. Book of John. Thank you so much, John, for your holy inspiration in doing that. And Jesus is. Now remember, the water, in certain cases in the Bible, is representative of the Word of God. Jesus is what? Is the Word. All right? And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus is the water that satisfies that we may never thirst. Jesus is the bread of life that we may never hunger. And that's what he's explaining to them. Okay, now remember, this all starts back when he says, listen, you came to me because your belly's full. He's like, but the bread that I am will fill you in ways that nothing else can. And that's the key. So many times we want to satisfy and fill the flesh to where it will go away and be done. But Jesus always satisfies, and it's always everlasting. Verse 36, but I say unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. Ouch. This verse, I love that he says this. Verse 37 is a good one. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. Don't ever forget that. He will never cast us out. The devil wants you to believe it's too late. There's no time. Jesus doesn't want to hear it. He's done with you. You've wasted your opportunity. It's all over. Forget about it. No way. Verse 37 blows all of that out of the water. All of it. Verse 37. All the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. If you need to write that verse down and post it somewhere in your house to where you don't forget that. Because the devil wants you sometimes, especially when we, act like people and make mistakes. Ah, you've done it again. You were doing good for so long, and you fell by the wayside. God's done with you. He's mad at you. He doesn't want anything to do with you. You messed up again. It's all over. Forget about it. Quit. You know what? Daniel just did the sign out there. Does a wonderful job on that, and he put on there, in trying times, don't quit trying. And that's the key, because Jesus will in no wise cast us out. Verse 38, why? For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. That's a good one, not just because it's the word of God, but remember, Jesus, as 100% man and 100% God, was surrendered to the will of the Father. It was Jesus surrendered to God's will for his life. That's important. You know, I walk cautiously on that because there's a fine line. We know that Jesus, 100% man, 100% God. But as 100% man, he was surrendered to the will of the Father. And that's our example. We will never be God, but we will always be human. So we can follow that example of Jesus to be surrendered to the will of the Father. That was an eye-opener for me. The book of Philippians talks about it. The Greek word is kenosis, of emptying of himself. But nonetheless, the idea, it was an eye-opener for me because I would read these things and be like, well, of course, Jesus can do that. He's Jesus. Well, of course, you know, he's going to so on and so forth, go through that and suffer this and suffer that. He's Jesus. He knows. No. I mean, there were things that he knew in his wisdom being surrendered to the Spirit, but in the flesh, he is tempted in all manner as we were, but yet was without sin. And that's important. It's not that we're elevating ourselves to a level of Jesus, but it's that Jesus came down and understood. That's how he was filled with compassion. And we see that he came down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. Verse 39, and this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that every one which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day. Remember that verse, because in just a few moments we're going to talk about something here. You know, again, he's made it very blatantly obvious. He is here surrendered to do the will of his Father, and the will of his Father is for them to believe on him that sent him, and anyone that comes to the Father, he will in no wise cast out, and he wants everyone to believe, and whosoever believes will have everlasting life. Now let's look at the Jews' response in verse 41. The Jews then murmured at him because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. And they said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he saith, I came down from heaven? So now they're starting to deflect. They're like, all right, he's not giving us what we want. We just wanted some more of that fancy bread that fills the baskets. We wanted maybe the manna like our fathers had. He's not even listening to what we're saying. All right, who is this guy anyways? Now he's talking about this. And they're murmuring. Beware of murmuring. There's in the book of Numbers, I believe it is there were some people that murmured against God. So he sent down a ring of fire and burned them right up. And that's how God feels about murmuring. Okay? Now in his grace and in his mercy, he withholds it from us. But it's not to say that we don't, you know, tempt the Lord our God when we murmur. And we see them murmuring here against Jesus. In verse 43, he says, Jesus therefore answered and said to them, murmur not among yourselves. He says, no, 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 that's enough. Not enough. No man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. The Calvinists love this verse, verse 44. They talk about, you know, that, you know, you can't come to the Father unless you're drawn unto him. And some of the, you know, the Calvinists will say, well, some will just not be drawn of the Father. Some will just will be born. They'll live on this earth, but they won't be drawn of the Father, and they won't be saved. They won't be one of the, sometimes they call it the elect. What a miserable existence that would be, to wonder if you're one of the elect, to wonder if God has drawn you. Well, you'll just know. I don't want to just know. Can you imagine that existence? I'm saying, is it now? Do I feel it? Is it this? Is it that? Absolutely not. The Calvinists love that verse, but we have so many refutes of that right in what Jesus is saying, because that's not what Jesus is saying. He's not saying that, you know, God, to suggest that would say that God's going to create some people and be like, well, I've created you, but you're not going to get saved. I'm not going to draw you. Does that correlate with for God so loved the world? Absolutely not. Can you imagine that? God creating people in his image. Now, there are people that God will create that God in his omniscience will say, well, they're not going to get saved. And he just knows that. It's not that he's resisting it. He's not that there's going to be opportunities for them too. It's just not going to happen because of their own free will, because of their own choice. But the Calvinist says that, well, they just weren't born to be saved. That's so far from what Jesus is talking about. Verse 45, it is written in the prophets, and they shall be all taught of God. Okay, right there again. It is written in the prophets, and they shall be all taught all taught of God, every man therefore that hath heard and hath learned of the Father cometh unto me. So he's saying, what he's talking about here is that, you know, the unsaved world are searching, but not always understanding that they're searching for God. Case in point would be, and some people will use this argument, what about the individual born on the island way off the coast, thousands of miles away from anybody, that, you know, doesn't know anything about anything? What you will see more than likely is they will have something set up as some form of an act of worship, because God has given them that innate sense within them that there is more out there than what they are seeing around them, that they need to reach out and that they need to worship something. And that's where it's our job to go and win them and go and reach them. And we see that, and we see it is written in the prophets, and they all, everyone's going to have an opportunity. Well, what about that one out in it? That's not my problem to solve. God knows the answer to that. There's a missionary that God would call to go to that island, that they need to be obedient and accept that call to do just that. But again, to suggest that there are some people that will be saved and some that won't, that is a true saying, but because God designed it that way, not so much. But what he's saying here is it's the Father that has put in us that innate ability to draw people unto him for salvation. See verse 46, not that any man hath seen the Father, save he which is of God. He that seen the Father, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. Okay, he said, it wasn't the manna that saves. They're dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. We'll stop right there for sake of time. I will write down that we're on verse 51. Okay, because we're really going to get into some stuff next week in regards to this. And I'm sorry we didn't get all the way to the end, but nonetheless, with some things we can take away is this. Number one, don't be surprised when unsaved people selfishly search for Jesus. Okay? Don't be surprised. Now, I'm not saying that in a condescending negative way. I'm not saying that as, Don't be surprised when unsaved people selfishly search for... They don't know. They don't understand. Don't be surprised when unsaved people act unsaved, all right? They don't know any better. Because it's good that people are searching, but it's up to us to point them in the right direction. And that's the biblical direction. The biggest thing we can learn from this is, yes, these people had a wrong motive. They had a wrong mindset, and they had a wrong manner about them. But nonetheless, we see that Jesus didn't stop witnessing, right? Keeps talking about the bread of life. He didn't stop witnessing. See, that's the key. And when we talk about not judging, people will come to us, and we need, and this is the way we take a stand for the truth and do it in the grace of God, is by praying for an opportunity to turn every conversation into a spiritual one, and by praying through the power of the Spirit that we use that opportunity to share the gospel in one way or another, whether or not they believe it or they reject it. That's not up to us. That is up to them. So now, next week, we'll be really getting into it when he starts talking about eating his flesh and drinking his blood and those kind of things. But again, he brings it all home. All right, so let's turn it over now to our prayer time. Does every... Ooh.